Well, happy Easter and welcome to Element Church. Is it good to be in church on a Sunday morning? Come on, let's test who's the church folk in the room. He is risen. All right, that was pretty good. A lot of people have missed it this morning. So, hey, if you're a first-time guest here, Element Church, how do we feel about our first-time guests? Come on, we love y'all. So grateful you're in the building this morning. I just really believe service is going to bless you. We're believing God to do some incredible things in some heads, in some hearts. Amen? Do you have faith for that? Yeah. Speaking of first-time guests, if you are a first-time guest in the room, I want to give you one of two options to connect with us. One, you could scan the QR code on the screen. Second thing you can do is grab a connection card from the seat back in front of you. Take some time to fill that out. You can bring it to our welcome center in the lobby. And if you bring it to the welcome center in the lobby, you get free goodies. And listen, we all love free goodies. Amen? The whole church said amen. We love free goodies. We have some amazing events coming up here at Element Church that I want to make sure you have on your calendar and you have an awareness for. On April 26th, we have our sisterhood event titled In All Season. Do I have any ladies in the room this morning? Yep, the ladies are always rowdy, but I love it. My own mother drives 3 hours from Springfield, Missouri to come attend these events. They're that good. Powerful preaching, powerful worship, really good food. And I know women and men alike, we all love great food. Somebody shout amen. Come on. We got to tell the truth in church, y'all. Hey, another thing we have coming up is our kids' summer day camp. This is going to be an awesome time for your kids. It's for ages 4, really up through 6th grade. If your kid falls into that 4 years old to kindergarten demographic, they're going to be provided half days, but the 1st through 6th graders will have full days July 15th through the 18th. Listen, they're going to receive the word of God. They're going to grow in their walk with the Lord, but they're also going to have a ton of fun while they're doing it. And then any parents like me who got some toddlers, we're praising God for 4 days of summer kids. And the whole church again said, amen. Thank you, Lord. Hey, we're doing something new here at Element Church. We're really excited about this. It's our Connect class. Our Connect class is going to be a 2-part class. The first one is April 21st. Second one is April 28th. And this is a class, whether you're brand new to Element Church or you've been coming for a while, maybe you're wanting to know more. You know, we have this name, our Connect class, and that's really exactly what it's all about. How do we get more connected with God? How do we get more connected with each other? How do we get more connected to the church? You know, there's also the unique opportunity within this Connect class. Maybe you have specific questions about Element Church. This will be a place to ask those questions. So not only will you learn about our background, what we believe, what our core values are, but there will be other awesome opportunities to grow and how you can get connected here at Element Church. And so I want to advise you, get it on the calendar. April 21st is session 1. April 28th is session 2. Okay? Again, listen, church, we're so grateful you're in the building. Service is amazing. It's going to bless your life. I promise you that. Are y'all ready for an incredible Easter service? I love it. Last little warning I want to give. There are some flashing lights and things of that sort. So if there is a specific sensitivity to that, just want to make sure you have some awareness before you sit through, all right? We'll get started in just about a minute here. Thank you for being at Element Church. Last thing I want to mention. And I'm back again. Here we go. Hey, if you guys are sitting, we're going to have a ton of people, and praise God for that. But also, it would be great if we could smooch. We don't need everybody smooching. Scooch is the word I'm looking for. Everybody say scooch. All right, if you could slide over even one or just 2 seats, that would be really, really helpful as we continue to have people come into the room. Look at your neighbor and say, I love sitting next to you. I love sitting next to you. All right, guys, thanks for being here. We'll get started in just a minute. Thank you.
cast my mind to Calvary, but Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on the cursed tree. Thank you.
You guys can be seated.
Welcome, everybody, to Element Church. Happy Easter weekend. So glad you are joining us. Yes. I just got a quick house cleaning announcement for all the guys that are wondering. No, I'm not wearing pink. This is salmon, okay? And I make it look good. I'm very secure in my masculinity. So, salmon. If you're a guest here at Element Church, we are so honored that you chose to be with us. We know you could be so many other places right now, so thank you for being here. This might be, yes, this might be a little bit out of the ordinary type of church experience. You might be going, am I in church? One thing I can guarantee you about Element Church is you will never fall asleep in a service. And we like to have fun. Why do we like to have fun? Because we believe that God is fun. Jesus said, I've come that you might have life and that you might have it abundantly. And so we believe that church should be fun. There was a pastor who lived a long life and he passed away and he was standing in the lines to enter heaven. Right in front of him, there was a guy wearing tattered jeans and a real loud shirt and a leather jacket and kind of long curly hair. And So St. Peter's there checking his list as people are coming in. So the man right in front of this pastor walks up and St. Pete says, tell me your name so I can check my list and to see whether or not I should let you in. So the man goes, my name's Joe Smith, New York City taxi cab driver. And so St. Pete looks and goes, yeah, sure enough, Joey, you're in here. And he goes, you know what? Here's your golden staff, and this angel's going to take you and show you your large heavenly mansion. Great job. Well done. Welcome to heaven. So the pastor's thinking, man, if that taxi cab driver got a big old mansion and a golden staff, I mean, like, man, I'm going to get a really big reward. So the pastor walks up and introduces himself and said, I was a pastor for 43 years. And so St. Pete looks at his list and goes, yeah, sure enough, you're on here. Here's your wooden staff. And right around the corner, you'll see your two-bedroom apartment. The pastor goes, well, hang on a second. I pastored for 43 years. And he goes, yeah, but up here in heaven, we reward based on results. See, when you preached, people slept. Well, he drove, people prayed. That's funny. You won't fall asleep here. As we come and celebrate and reflect on the elements of Easter, many people are aware of kind of the high focal points of the Easter story. You're aware that Jesus, the night that he was betrayed, went to the Garden of Gethsemane, and there he prayed so intensely that literally his brow would sweat blood. And many know that he was given a false trial, and the crowd shouted, crucify him, and he carried his cross to Calvary, and there he died. Many know the third day, and what we're celebrating is that Jesus rose from the dead. Many people know the facts about Easter, but they don't know the why. They don't truly understand and fathom how the story of Easter impacts and changes their life today. And I just want to take a moment to reflect on the power of the story of Easter and its meaning for your life. To fully grasp it, we have to go all the way back to the beginning. We see Jesus in a garden. We see him placed in a garden tomb. But the reason for that is because everything started all the way back in another garden. Genesis chapter 1, God created Adam, created Eve, and placed them inside of a garden called the Garden of Eden. And God put a little boundary there for them as a loving heavenly father to protect them. I want to read this in Genesis 2. And the Lord commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden you may freely eat, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat, for in the day that you eat of it you will surely die. Now, there are over 300,000 species of fruit-bearing trees. That's a lot of fruit-bearing trees. That would take a long time to get through all those trees. And God said, look, guys, there's just one tree that I don't want you to eat. Now, God didn't put a boundary on the one because he's a cosmic killjoy, because he wanted to be restricting from people having fun and enjoying life. As a good, gracious Heavenly Father, he put a boundary on there because he knew that that tree on the other side of it was death, pain, and destruction. God gets a bad rap. A lot of people think that God is a cosmic killjoy with a lightning bolt in his hand, ready just to zap you if you look just the wrong way. But not true. He's gracious and he's loving. See, if you're out for a walk and you come across this sign that says, warning, electric fence, do you get all mad and bent out of shape? Well, I can't believe how mean and controlling and restricting that person is to limit my walk and then limit my joy and limit my fun. No, you go, hey, thank you for letting me know. If you're out driving on your road and you come across these warning signs, hey, bridge out, do you get upset and go, you know what? It's my path. I can drive whatever path I want. And who are you to limit me? Who are you to be so narrow-minded? Floor it and just go on for a leap? No. Well, some people, yeah, but most don't. If you're thirsty and you need some hydration and you come across these bottles that have a warning label on it, do you get upset and just go, hey, my body, my choice? You know, you do what's right for you. I'll do what's right for me. Who are you to tell me what's right and what's wrong? And you know what? I'm sincere. And as long as I'm sincere, it's okay. Well, you're going to be sincerely dead. That's what's going to be happening. No, you understand that those labels are there to protect you. So God, because he's love, has to give man a choice. Because God created man because he wanted to be loved in return. And because love gives. And so he wants a relationship. But if love doesn't have a choice, then it's not love, it's dictatorship. So he said, Adam, I'm going to give you a choice whether or not you want to love me, whether or not you're going to trust me. And that's why he put the one tree that was a choice. Yeah. Well, unfortunately, we know what happened. Adam and Eve were out for a walk one day. Adam wanted to stay home and watch the game, but Eve made him go. And so they're out, and they're out doing some proto shopping, and we come across what happened next. And so now the serpent was more cunning than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made, and he said to the woman, has God indeed said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden? And the woman said to the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit in the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, you shall not eat it, nor shall you touch it, lest you die. And then the serpent said to the woman, you will not surely die, for God knows that in the day you eat of it, your eyes will be opened. You'll be like God, knowing good and evil. We see the same tactics that Satan still uses thousands of years later. First, he questions the word of God. Did God really say? Is that what God really meant? Next, we see people adding to the word, because God said, not to eat it. Adam and Eve added, thou shalt not touch it. And so that's what religion often does, is add a lot of things to what God says. And then he questions the character of God. He goes, look, God's holding out on you. God knows this is the best fruit. God doesn't want you to be like him. The truth is this, they were already like God because God said, let us make man in our image. And Satan still uses the same tactics today. People ask all the time, why is there so much destruction and disease and terrible things when I turn on the news taking place around the world? Well, I'll tell you this, it's not God. Insurance policies get it wrong because they go, it's the act of God clause, act of God. It's not an act of God when there's tornadoes and there's destruction that takes place. It's because we live in a fallen world because man rebelled against God and did what they shouldn't do. And they said, we'll be our own God. We'll define our own morality. We can make our own choices. We don't need God. We can be God. And the reason the world is in the corrupt state that is in is because of sin. Now, many of you like me feel like, man, I can't wait to see Adam and Eve and tell them how I really feel for them screwing up my life. But before you go throw a rock at Adam and Eve, remember this. Every day, chances are you make the same choices they made. It just might not be at the same tree. Might be on the television. It might be at your computer. It might be at what you say at the gossip cooler, water cooler at the office. But we all have been given free will, and just like Adam and Eve, we still often choose to be our own God, to define our own morality, and to live our own way. And thus, because of sin and high treason against the Creator, we live in a world full of pain, full of destruction. But I love God because he wasn't done. He goes, look, you messed up, but I got a plan to bring things back to you. But Adam and Eve, they had a plan to fix it themselves too. They realized that they messed up. So because man is so, we're hardworking, we're smart, we got a plan to fix it. So we see the eyes of them both were opened, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together of themselves and made coverings. They realized there was something missing. They realized that they were naked, and so they covered it up themselves. And we still have the same issue going on today. People are born innately with a hole inside of their heart. They know there's something void. They know there's something missing. They know they don't have it all together, and so we live a life covering up. We live a life wearing masks. We live a life trying to fill the hole in our heart. If I can just climb the corporate ladder, if I can get enough degrees, if I can accumulate enough money, if I can go to enough places, if I can have enough relational experiences, whatever it is for you. But at the end of the day, it's most people's attempt to cover up the nakedness and the hole inside of their heart. But God comes along and says, I got something better for you. And so he killed the first innocent animal, and he made for Adam and Eve a covering of clothing from animal skin. And it was really just a glimpse of what ultimately would have to happen to restore man back to paradise that they lost. That would be innocent blood would have to be shed for man to be restored and to be forgiven. And so inside of the gospel, inside of the Old Testament, there's this passage of scripture that a lot of people, maybe if you've read your Bible and you get to about Genesis chapter 5 and 6, you start falling asleep because there's this little thing called genealogies, and it's this list of names that feel really boring, and you're like, why is that even there? I don't really care who had so-and-so, and so-and-so had yabba-dabba, and yabba-dabba had yabba-doo, whoop-de-doo. But even inside of a genealogy, God gave us the plan of salvation thousands of years before he would implement it through Jesus Christ. I want to show you this. These are the names of Adam's descendants, and in Hebrew, they all have meanings. And we'll see the story of salvation laid out here. Man, Seth, is appointed. Enos, mortal. Canaan, sorrow. Mahalalel, the blessed God. Jared shall come down. Enoch shall teach. Methuselah, his death shall bring. Lamech, the despairing. Noah, comfort and rest. When you put that together, this is literally what it says. Man is appointed mortal sorrow, but the blessed God shall come down, and teaching his death shall bring despairing comfort and rest. That's the gospel. We were lost. We were without hope. But God said, you can't get to me, and I'm going to come down to you, and I'm going to teach you the love of my Father, and I'm going to die for you so that your soul can finally find comfort and finally find rest. The whole Old Testament can really just be summarized as pictures, glimpses, types, and shadows, all pointing to the plan of salvation that would be in the person of Jesus Christ. But we are still hardworking, and we still can get to heaven on our own. Now, I love St. Louis because it's the most saved city in the United States of America. You didn't know that, but now you know. Everybody in St. Louis is going to heaven. You can't find any city in the United States where everybody, 2.8 million people, are all going to heaven except St. Louis. Like, we know New York, going to hell. LA, hell, splitting it wide open. St. Louis, we're all going to heaven. Now, one of my favorite things to do is wreck people's day. Now, that kind of sounds weird coming from a pastor, but just hang in here with me, because it's really a lot of fun. You should try this sometime. Like, if somebody just seems like they're having way too much fun and they're annoying you, do this. It's great. Hey, let me ask you a quick question. If you were to die today, would you go to heaven or hell? So fun. To see the look on their face just dramatically change. Their smile just turn into a, what? Do you know something I don't know? Maybe. It's St. Louis. Now, in St. Louis, I have always gotten the same answer. You know it because you use it too. So the next question is this. Why? Everybody's going to heaven. And the next question is, well, why are you going to heaven? Well, what's the answer? Because I'm a
good person.
Say it again. Because I'm a
good person.
Everybody in St. Louis is a good person.
yeah, I just shot those people, but they deserved it. I did the world a favor. You're welcome. Yeah, I'm dealing some stuff, but I give to the goodwill dude out there with the bell. Like, yeah, I'm a good person. I help old people across the street, and yeah, I take their wallet when I get them there. But I'm a good person. I mean well. I'm sincere. Everybody's going to heaven because they're a good person. God knew that this would be a universal issue for mankind. So God gave Moses to be a deliverer to the nation of Israel. After he delivered them from Egypt, they go out into the wilderness. They go to Mount Sinai. We know Moses goes up on top of the mountain. He's up there 40 days, and then he comes down with two tablets with the Ten Commandments. Now, a lot of people think that God gave the Ten Commandments so that we could be saved, so that we can get to salvation, but he didn't. He gave it, one, because it's the greatest moral compass for a civil society. For any society to exist without anarchy and without chaos, you have to have a moral compass. The Ten Commandments is the greatest moral compass. In fact, this nation was founded on the Ten Commandments. It was etched into every government building. It was on the wall in every classroom, and the Bible was a textbook in every class. In 1960, we threw God out because we got artificial intelligence earlier than science, and we thought we didn't need God, we didn't need prayer, and we didn't need the Ten Commandments in our school. And how are we doing? How's that working out? Great. Not very well. So it's a compass for a moral society. But secondly, God gave it because, as Paul said, it's a tutor to bring us to Christ. See, you can't get righteousness through keeping the law because you can't keep it. I'm going to share a secret with you that most people don't know and you would never guess, and it's this. Growing up, I was incredibly, incredibly good at basketball. In fact, I was like NBA draft material. Now, I know you're looking at me and you're going, dude, you're 5'10", sporting a salmon-colored jacket. No way you were good at basketball, but I was. I could slam dunk under the leg. I could slam dunk over. I could slam dunk over my head. I was amazing at slam dunk. I won every slam dunk contest against my 5-year-old son, and I won every one-on-one game against my 5-year-old son because, so like, he had this little basketball thing, and I could stand and slam dunk. I could under the leg and slam dunk. I was amazing. Why? Because I'm playing against my 5-year-old son with a plastic basketball hoop. Now, had you taken me and thrown me out on the NBA court, would have been humiliating. See, many of us, we think we're good. We think we're slam dunking righteousness. We think that we're MJ in the air, over the back, dunking goodness. And God says, yeah, it's because you're using the wrong goal. See, you can always feel good about yourself because you can always find somebody else to make you feel good about yourself. That's why you troll social media. You're just looking for somebody else to make you feel good. You're like, whoa, they're idiots. I'm so good. The truth is, when you look at most people and the people they hang out with, and you look at their friends and you go, why do they hang out with them? It's just because those friends make them feel better about themselves. That's all. They don't actually like them. They just like how stupid they are because they feel good. Most people use a standard of goodness because you can always find somebody that you're better than. Yeah, you're better than Jeffrey Dahmer. So what? So God gave the standard to let you know what good is. That's what the Ten Commandments was given for, to show you. You're playing against the wrong hoop. And so let's just go through the quick test, a little pop quiz today. Here we go, 5 of the Ten Commandments. You shall have no other gods before me. That simply means that God should be and must be loved more than anything else, because nothing and no one deserves to be loved more than God. He gave you life. He's the one who created you. He's the one who holds your body together and the DNA, and he causes your heart to beat. He gave you life. He should be first. Amen. Well, how do you know if God is first? I don't have any Buddha statues in my living room, but here's what you know. You give your time, your talent, and your treasure to the thing you love the most. What are you most passionate about? I know in St. Louis, our God here in St. Louis City, sports. Because I've seen you all worshiping at the Cardinals Stadium. Woo! Woo! You come into church.
and you look like a crazy person out there at a sporting event worshiping for your team. Soccer mom, you're crazy. We love you. You're crazy. Screaming out there like your kid's got a chance to make it anywhere, let alone pro sports. We know what you love. Look, you put your time and your passion into the thing you love most. All right, that hurt. Let's just move along. Honor your father and mother. Do you know in the Old Testament, because sin is deadly, sin kills. So God had the death penalty for a kid who dishonored their father and mother. How many? Some of you are like, you know what? Let's get a little Old Testament back. Because I got a couple kids. And you only have to execute it with one and the rest go, oh, okay, all right. Now, as much as you like that, mom and dad, you'd be dead already. Your parents would have killed you too. So you wouldn't have been alive to reproduce. So, all right. You shall not commit adultery. Jesus said, if you've looked at someone to lust after them in your own heart, you've committed adultery. Moving right along. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. What's that? Gossip? Slander? Telling half-truths and spinning it to make you look good, to make somebody else look bad? Again, we pretty much just call it social media. And then you shall not covet. Coveting is wanting more of what you already have enough. And if there's any nation on the planet or the earth that covets, it's this nation. We are in debt and our eyeballs. We bought a bunch of things we couldn't afford to impress people that don't matter. We got garages full of junk and can't even park our cars in there because it's full of junk. All right, that's 5 out of 10. How'd you do? I got 100%. Wrong. Yeah, we all did. Every one of us failed. God gave the law to simply show you, you can never, ever be good enough. You can't achieve righteousness by keeping the law. Yes, it's a great moral compass, but it's also just going to remind you each and every day that you fail miserably short of the standard of God. Well, if I can't earn heaven, what did I earn? Good question, because the Bible tells us. Romans 6:23, the wages, which is earnings, the wages of sin is death. Now, death doesn't just mean physical death. Sin brings death of relationships, death of dreams, death of vision. But more than that, it brings spiritual death. See, Jesus said that he is life, that life is in God, that apart from him, there is no life. So death is eternal separation from the life of God. It's in a literal place called hell. Now, I'm going to make you feel uncomfortable for a moment. Because there's not enough churches that talk about the reality of hell. See, you can't understand the goodness of the gospel. You can't understand and appreciate Jesus' death and resurrection if you don't know what it is that he came to save you from. If you don't know how bad hell is, you don't understand the price that he paid and appreciate what he gave you in his death and his resurrection. The Bible's not just referring to hell as a metaphor, as some figment, you know, of somebody's imagination, or as a word just to describe evil. A lot of people, in fact, 2/3 of people today don't believe in a literal place called hell. But the Bible references hell over 150 times as a literal place. Jesus taught on hell more than he taught on heaven because he knew the reality of hell. In fact, 33 times Jesus talked about hell. Jesus ministered for 3.5 years. That means Pastor Jesus in his church service had a sermon on hell once a month. Some of you grew up in that church. Hell! Why? Because it's real. But Jesus said that hell was not created for you and for me. God created heaven for us. The hell was created for the devil and his angels. But those who choose to live like the devil, to say, I will be my own God, I don't need you to rule over me, end up in the same place the devil does because they did the same thing he did. But God said the only way you can get to a place called hell is you'll have to step over the dead body of my son, Jesus Christ. Because God will do everything he can short of violating your will to get you into a place called heaven. Hell is horrible and it's eternal because it's the complete absence of God. Everything good you can trace back to God. See, hell is the absence of God, therefore it's the absence of all that he is. Hell's eternal darkness. because Jesus is the light of the world. You remove light and all you have is dark. Hell is eternal torment because in Jesus is fullness of joy. Therefore, you remove Jesus, you have the complete opposite of fullness of joy. It's eternal thirst because Jesus is the living water. It's eternal hunger because Jesus is the bread of life. Hell is horrible. It's not a party. That's why Jesus died. To save you and I from a hell we deserve. I'm so glad Jesus didn't stop as scripture was being recorded. The wages of sin is death. Good luck. There's an incredible conjunction. It's the greatest conjunction in all the Bible. It's the word but. Everybody say but. I'm so grateful for that but. It's the best looking but you'll ever see. And it's right here. But the free gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Again, Jesus didn't come down from heaven to say, hey, you're all going to hell. God's mad. I just want to let you know, extra crispy for you. He came down to say, hey, there is a hell, but I paid the price for your sin so you don't have to go there, so that through me and my death and resurrection, you can get a heaven you could never earn and never deserve. Imagine an ant trying to relate to you. Like when you look at an ant, that's just somebody's fingertip and that little ant touching. That's a really cool picture. But imagine you and I are like the ant. Like we can't fathom this person's day, their feelings, their emotions, their plans, their thoughts. Einstein's theory of relativity. This ant lives in this small little sphere, this little small world, and it can't even comprehend our life. Traveling around the world, the places that we know. It can't. See, you and I are like this ant in size of God compared to God. You and I can't fathom God. In fact, the Bible never says understand God. It simply says trust God. Because like an ant, we can't. He's so far beyond our ability to comprehend. So what God said is you can't understand me. You can't get to me. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to become one of you. The only way for us to fully understand God is he had to become like one of us. And that's what Jesus did. When he left heaven 2,000 years ago to be born of a virgin named Mary, to be placed in a manger, it was Jesus taking the form of the ant, so to speak. It was Jesus saying, you can't get to me, you can't understand me, so I'm going to come to you. I'm going to walk among you, I'm going to be like you, so I can show you exactly what the Father looks like. Jesus said, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. I only do what I see the Father do. I only say what I see what I hear the Father say. And all we see in Jesus is a representation of how amazing God the Father is. We see his love and we see his compassion. We see people with leprosy coming down to Jesus who were outcasts of society, people that wouldn't be touched by anyone else, kneeling before Jesus and saying, Jesus, if you're willing, you can make me clean. The question was not the power of Jesus, but the willingness of Jesus. And there are some of you here today consumed with the spiritual leprosy of sin, and your life stinks, so to speak, and your life feels like it's decaying and falling apart, and you don't question the power of God, but you question the willingness of God to touch you. And Jesus settled that question. He said, I'm willing, be clean. And not only that, he touched the untouchable person, because Jesus wants to touch your life. No matter how bad your life has been, no matter how far low, how down you have gone, no matter what sin is in your closet, Jesus cares about you, and he can touch your life. Jesus walked among us for 3.5 years, showing us the love of the Father, the compassion of the Father. Yet there were a group of religious people who didn't like Jesus, didn't like the message of Jesus. Jesus didn't fit into their little box. They were messing with this plan, so they said, let's silence his voice. We have the same culture today that doesn't like God because he doesn't fit into their little box, and they want to silence Christianity and silence the voice of Jesus today. We still have the same problems. So they stirred up a group of people to bring about a false trial for him. Now, Jesus, the night that he was going to be betrayed, he went out into a garden. Why a garden? Why in a garden did he kneel down and pray, Father, if at all possible, let this cup pass from me, yet not my will, but thy will be done. Because mankind lost salvation in a garden, it needed to be redeemed in another garden. Adam in the garden said, my will be done. In a garden, Jesus said, thy will be done. Adam lost it at a tree. Jesus is going to regain it at another tree called the cross.
God told Adam that because you've sinned, the ground is going to produce thorns and thistles. And because the ground was cursed to produce thorns and thistles, and he said that by the sweat of your brow will you earn a living. Jesus in the garden sweat blood from his brow. Later, a crown of thorns would be placed into his skull because Jesus redeemed us from the curse that Adam brought upon us in the garden. We lost it in the garden. Jesus got it in another garden. If it was all possible, let this cup pass for me. If there was any other way for man to be saved, God the Father would have then said, hey, it's okay. You don't have to die, Jesus, because all roads lead to the top of the same mountain. At the end of the day, everybody's trying to get to the same place. It's all good. You don't need to die. Because there was no other way, Jesus had to die. He was arrested. He was brought before accusers. False trial, handed over to Pilate. The crowd began to shout, crucify him. They beat Jesus back with a cat of nine tails till he was a bloody pulp. Up to the point of death, 39 lashes. A crown of thorns was placed in his skull. He was forced to carry his cross. And when they had come to the place called Calvary, there they crucified him and criminals on his right and on the left. When they crucified Jesus by putting the nails in his hands, they lift up the cross. There's a hole in the ground about 3 feet deep. The cross would slide into that hole, and the weight of that victim's body would tear their joints and tendons when it hit the bottom with the thud. And as Jesus hung there, the crowds mocked him. They shouted, he saved others. Why doesn't he save himself? He could have saved himself, but he didn't come to save himself. He came to save you, amen. And he came to save me. And from the cross, he said, Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. I would have said something. I ain't Jesus. I'm a work in progress. And there we see, then when the sun is darkened and when Jesus has cried out with a loud voice, he said, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. And having said this, he breathed his last. I can imagine the disappointment in the disciples and the followers of Christ seeing their Messiah, the one they hoped in to be the Savior of Israel, die. Their dreams died with Christ. The disillusionment that the Messiah, the one they trusted in, left everything to follow, is now dead. They took Jesus' bloodied, broken body and placed it in a tomb. Fog of fear, a fog of disappointment, a fog of disillusionment set in over the hearts and minds of the followers of Jesus. In 1815, all of England lay in fear and trepidation because Napoleon was conquering Europe. And England knew they had one last hope to defeat Napoleon, and that was General Wellington. If General Wellington couldn't defeat Napoleon, it was just a matter of time before Napoleon would have finished conquering Europe and made its way into England to conquer England. So all of England was in fear. All of England was waiting for the message on the day of the outcome of the battle between Napoleon and Wellington. Late in the afternoon, there was a signal fired from a ship to relay a message of the outcome of that battle. The first word that came was Wellington. Moments later, the next word to come, defeated. And then a fog came in over the ships. All of England began to panic, Wellington defeated. They began to fear and wonder, what are they going to do? What's Napoleon going to do when he comes and conquers them? But after a while, the fog lifted, and there was another signal that was fired to get their attention because there was a third word, Napoleon. Altogether, the message said, Wellington defeated Napoleon. What a difference that third word made. See, on the first day, Satan thought he defeated Jesus. On the second day, he thought, I defeated Jesus. But on the third day, the day that made a difference, Jesus rose from the dead. Jesus defeated the devil. Jesus defeated death. And now on the final day of the week, very early in the morning,
They and certain women with them came to the tomb bringing spices when they had prepared, but they found the stone rolled away from the tomb. And when they went in, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. And it happened as they were greatly perplexed about this, that behold, two men stood by them in shining garments. Then as they were afraid, bowed their faces to the earth and said to them, why do you seek the living among the dead? He is risen. We come to celebrate the fact that Jesus is risen. You can go to all the religious leaders' tombs in history today, and their body's still there. Muhammad is still in the tomb. Buddha's still in his tomb. Confucius is still in his tomb. But there is one tomb that's empty, and that is the tomb of a resurrected Jesus Christ. And there's one interesting fact that's often overlooked that I want to share in the Gospel of John, John 20, verse 6. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb and saw the linen cloths lying there and the handkerchief that had been around his head, not lying with the linen cloths, but folded together in a place by itself. We just kind of read over that, but the people of that day would have understood what that meant. A folded napkin meant something. See, when a rich man was being served dinner inside of his home, the person that was serving dinner would stand off outside of the distance and watch. And then when that leader of the house was done eating, they would stand up and take the napkin and wipe their face, crumple it up, and throw it on the table, and they'd walk away. That was a signal to let that person know they can now clear the table. He's done. But if that head of the house wasn't done, they would fold the napkin, set it by the side, and then walk away, but that let the servant know, I'm coming back. Jesus folded the napkin because he's coming back. And the question is, are you ready when Jesus comes back? Every head bowed, every eye closed, let me pray for you today. Jesus, thank you for these precious people whom you love, whom you died for, whom you have an incredible plan, that you died for all of us, that we could miss a hell we deserve, that we could be given a heaven we could never deserve. I pray for anyone that doesn't know you, maybe anyone that's wandered from you, that with your love, your grace, and your goodness today, that you would draw them to yourself, to the point of accepting and receiving the free gift of eternal life. In the person of Jesus. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Precious blood has left me forgiven. Pure like the whitest of snow, powerful to make sin and shame a retreat. This covenant is making me whole. So I will arise and lift my head, for by his mercy my life was spared. The highest name has set me free. Because of Jesus, my heart is clean. Purify my heart in your presence. Teach me to discover the joy of holiness that forms as you draw me close. In you what was lost is restored. So I will arise and lift my head, for by his mercy my life was spared. The highest name has set me free. Because of Jesus, my heart is clean. So I will arise and lift my head, for by his mercy my life was spared. The highest name has set me free. Because of Jesus, my heart is clean. Because of Jesus, my heart is clean.
Come on, let's all stand together. There was a moment when the lights went out.
When death had claimed its victory.
It was my sin that held him there.
It was my sin that held him there.
It was my sin that held him there.
His dying breath has brought me life.
I
know that it is finished.
I know that it is finished.
It is finished.
The cross has spoken. I am
the cross has spoken.
The cross has spoken. I am forgiven.
Then bursting forth in glory to day, there will be a day when all will bow before him.
Standing face to face
with he who died and rose again.
I can only imagine.
you bow your head and close your eyes just one more time, what can you imagine? Because one day you will stand before God and he's going to ask you, what did you do with my son? The Bible says if we confess with our mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in our heart that God raised him from the dead, we'll be saved. Salvation, eternal life, heaven is simply a prayer away. I'd love to lead you in that prayer today. Right there, online, St. Charles, Warrenton. I'd love to lead you in that prayer. Maybe you've known Jesus, but you've wandered, you've drifted, you're away. Today you can come back home with this prayer. We love you. We believe in you. Think of all the things that you've tried that haven't worked. Why not try Jesus? You'll never regret it. Let's say this together. Jesus, thank you that you left heaven to come to earth because I couldn't get to you. You hung on a cross that should have been mine. You took my sins and nailed it to the cross. And you rose from the dead on that third day so you could fill my empty heart. I confess you as my Savior, you as my Lord. I surrender my life to follow you. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. Let's give him a big hand clap.
I don't know, church. This is the greatest news on earth. I think we can give God more praise. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. You've done what we could never do. We give you glory. We give you honor. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Praise you, Lord. You guys could be seated for just a moment here. What an incredible Sunday. Amen? Hey, as Pastor Eric shared the opportunity to say that prayer at the end there, maybe you've been distant from God for a while and you feel it's time to return home. You hear him calling. You sense him knocking on your heart. Maybe you said that prayer for the first time. You haven't had a relationship with Jesus. You know, here at Element, we don't want to just usher you into a relationship with God and then say, all right, hope it goes well. We want to get something practical in your hands to come alongside you on this journey with Jesus. And so you can text the number on the screen. Text I decided to the number on the screen if this pertains to you. And we'll get a free 7-day devotional in your hands. Again, it's just our way of coming alongside you in this walk with God, okay? Come on, can we celebrate anybody who made that decision? It's awesome. In the next coming weeks here, we're going to be moving into a series titled Know God. And that's a play on words there. We know there's many things about our faith that require belief without seeing. And we know that there's even special blessing that comes with that. But there's also things that pertain to Jesus that I think as we look into them, whether it's historically, factually, statistically, it's things that, well, I actually think help solidify our faith. Certain things we can look at and say, okay, that's got to be God. And so we want to invite you. I believe this series is going to strengthen your faith. I think it's going to give you, it's just going to equip you in a new way in your walk with the Lord. So not only you come, but bring somebody with you, maybe specifically someone who's been struggling with their faith. I know this will minister to them. Hey, experiences like this morning, like Easter, they don't happen without the faithful giving and tithes and offerings from all of you. And so if you've given online this week already, I want to say thank you for being faithful to this house. Thank you for giving. Thank you for your generosity. If that doesn't pertain to you, we have multiple ways you can participate. Today, we'll have our ushers in the back. You can leave a gift on your way out. Or we have other ways that you can give, all of which are safe and secure. Okay, it's one of the best ways to contribute and be connected at the church. But another way to be connected at the church here is, or an entryway to get connected is going to be through our Connect class, which is a 2-part series. I mentioned this on the front end of service, but the first session is on April 21st. Second session is going to be April 28th. This is something new we're doing here at Element. But, you know, maybe you've been coming to Element for a long time. Maybe you're brand new this morning. Regardless of where you fall on that spectrum, this class is for you. You're going to learn about the core values and the foundation of the church. How did we get started? You'll also have the unique opportunity to ask any questions you might have about Element. Ultimately, this class is going to provide you the opportunity to get more connected to God, first and foremost, more connected to each other, more connected to the church. It's going to be great. Make sure you get on your calendar and make it an emphasis to be there, okay? Hey, I know on a Sunday like Easter, we come in looking pretty. Our teeth are white, we dress nice, maybe sprayed on a little cologne. But if we were to be honest and transparent, although we look good on the outside, we may be deteriorating on the inside. I don't know, maybe there's depression in the room. Maybe there's sickness in the room. We get that this is a room full of imperfect people, and for that reason, we have a prayer team that'll be up here at the front. Listen, I want to encourage you. If there's something you're walking through, something you need prayer for, our team is going to be up here, and I just believe, we believe, Element believes in the power of prayer. When the people of God come together and make their requests known, God heals, He restores, He hears, He ministers in only ways that He can. And so take advantage of that prayer team, all right? Don't get me preaching up here, y'all. Come on, I want to bless you before you go. Such an awesome Easter to spend with you guys. If you wouldn't mind, stand to your feet. I want to speak a blessing over you. Again, thanks for being here. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up His countenance upon you and give you His peace. Go in the grace of God. Happy Easter.
For us.